Very good evening to you all. Thank you so much for coming here. Thank you for making time. I'm supposed to read a very long biography of the speaker, but he told me not to. And actually, this is a very compressed version of his biography, actually. So if for the ones who want to know, you can Google it further. I'm very delighted to introduce this evening's speaker. It has been my dream to listen to him live and hear my hosting him and making him speak in the very institute I'm studying. It's overwhelming. Guinness is an author, a social critic, and he graduated from Oxford University, and he has been working at think tank in Washington, D.C., and that's all he wants you to know. Actually, it's much more than that. We're so grateful, sir, for accepting our invitation and coming here to speak to us. I would like the student union president to please come and give him the Tata Institute of Social Sciences shawl that we customarily give to our speakers.
It's a tremendous privilege for me to be here at the Tata Institute. I appreciate it deeply. Some years ago, I was at Stanford University, and a student asked me a question no one has asked me before. If you could be a member of any generation except the one you were born in, which would you choose? I was born in China. And I know the history of China very well, its great dynasties. I'm a great admirer of the Greeks and Athens and Rome, and of course, coming from England and knowing America, all sorts of ideas went through my mind. But what I said in answer to them, I would like to be a member of your generation. Because you are described as the crunch generation. What does that mean? In the global era, many of the big issues of our world are coming together and converging to create a crunch. Issues that will have to be answered in your adulthood. Economic, technological, scientific, environmental, nuclear, many, many issues. But underlying many of those issues is a very simple but profound question. How do we live with our deep differences? And especially with the deepest religious and ideological differences. And that little question underlies many of the other questions. And if we're going to live in a world that negotiates these things peacefully and constructively, we really need to understand how we live with our deepest differences. And many of our countries today are becoming challenged and moving away from good answers. And I know there are many questions raised here in England, here in India, as there certainly are in England and in America, where I'm living at the moment in Washington, D.C. The Americans, for example, were described more than 200 years ago as having the true remedy for handling diversity. But in the last 50 years, they've had endless culture warring, and much of the best of their system is breaking down. And I know in the same way, India has a reputation for being extremely tolerant. But in the last few years, even your reputation has come under stress. So this issue, how do we live with our deep differences? I want to share with you my thinking and put some ideas forward to you. But of course, the challenge is each one of you must come to your own convictions and hopefully have a position that you're able to argue for in the public square so that India and Asia and maybe the world can move towards a better position So in an age of extraordinary diversity, especially religious and ideological diversity, we can know how to negotiate these differences peacefully and not violently or coercively. That's what I want to talk about. Let me put out a number of areas for you and ask you to think through some of these, and then I want to open it for questions and hear what you think, and I know I've got a lot to learn from you. First of all, though, think why this issue has become so urgent today. We are seeing a search for a new world order in the global era. The old ideas of a balance of power are breaking down. The threat in some parts of the world is the rise of a new empire. And in other parts of the world, you see a cataclysm of failed states and chaos and violence and death. Think of Syria and Libya. But particularly, notice that in the last 50 years, we are seeing an explosion of religious and ideological diversity. When I was your age and a student, I'm a graduate, the so-called secularization theory was dominant. The idea the world becomes more modern, the world becomes less religious. But beginning with the Iranian Revolution in 1979, that theory disappeared. That theory believed that Europe was the vanguard, America was somehow the odd man out, the most modern country in the world, also the most religious of modern countries in the world. But people believed the world would go the way of Europe, and that is terribly wrong. Since then, we've seen an explosion of religion all over the world, and sometimes literally explosive, with conflict and violence. Now, in that situation, many of the traditional ways of handling these things have broken down in the West and in many other parts of the world. Take the French. As in many countries, a particular year was very important in France and in other countries and put its stamp on French history. And obviously for the French, that year was 1789 and the French Revolution. And the radicals had a little cry, "We want to strangle the last king with the guts of the last priest." Rather brutal for the kings and the priests, but you understand what they were saying. You had a church and a state that were in collusion. They were both oppressive to the people, both corrupt. So the revolution threw off both and made a radical separation of church and state, what the French called laïcité. And 200 more years later, it is breaking down under the impact of all the immigration from North Africa, especially the Muslim immigration, and you can see the recent terrorist attacks in Paris and so on. You can see how the French system, which has been so strong for so long, is today breaking down. I said the American system, which goes back to 1791 and the so-called First Amendment, where they disestablished religion, but it flourished because it was made voluntary. But in the last 50 years, because of the culture warring, all sorts of legal battles over religion and public life, the American system is under stress. And you could go around various countries, and it's no secret that you have your own concerns here. And many people are raising the question, India has been such an example of tolerance, but will it remain so for people of all faiths and no faiths in the future? Now, as this has happened, this explosion of religion and ideology, we're beginning to see the emergence of what's called a global public square. What does that mean? The idea of a public square goes back to the Greeks. If you go to Athens, you can see the agora. Not a marketplace, but the public space, the public square, where citizens came together to debate and decide the issues of their common public life. It was a physical place. Later for the Romans, it was the Forum. In England, we have Westminster, the Houses of Parliament. In France, they have the Assemblée. In America, they have Capitol Hill, a public square. Of course, you have that in New Delhi. That's a physical place. But then the public square became a metaphor. It wasn't a physical place. It could be a newspaper, or a television show, or a radio program. But wherever citizens were coming together to debate issues that mattered to common public life, that was a public square. But now, of course, in the age of the internet, it's gone from the physical place to the metaphor to the virtual. And that's one of the lessons of the last 20 or 30 years. You may have followed the responses to Salman Rushdie's famous book, Satanic Verses, or the response to the Danish cartoon controversy, or when the Pope made a speech at the University of Regensburg. And if you see the violent responses around the world to these things, you see a very simple fact. Today, even when we're not speaking to the world, we can be heard by the world, and the world can organize a violent response. And we see the beginning of a very rudimentary, very early, small, but a very definite global public square. And at the moment, it's not going so well. For example, you see when you have anonymous screen names on the blogs, people are not responsible with their own names there, and the rhetoric quickly descends to violence and degradation and language which is more barbaric than democratic. Now put all that together, and you can see this issue of living with our deepest differences is now a global issue that will have to be answered if we're not to go the way of coercion and violence. And of course, see, the last century, the 20th century, was the most murderous century in all human history. 100 million people were killed in war. More than 100 million were killed in political repression. Mao Zedong in China, maybe 75 million. And another 100 million were killed in sectarian violence, as you know, some of that between India and Pakistan and so on. And so you can see in the last century, 1/3 of a billion human beings were killed by their fellow human beings for one reason or another. And this is one of those areas of sectarian violence and state oppression which we will need to answer to really work out how we live with our deep differences peacefully, respectfully, and know how to negotiate those differences. As President Kennedy said, we need to know how to make a world safe for diversity. So think of that first point. That gives the urgency to the topic we're talking about. Secondly, think through the importance of freedom of conscience as the principal answer to this challenge. There are a number of arguments for freedom of conscience and for religious freedom. The first of which is that this idea is the first liberty. If you take the three political rights that are fundamental, freedom of conscience, freedom of speech, and freedom of assembly or association, there is no hierarchy. They're all important. But they're interlocking and interdependent. And if you think the deepest one of them all is freedom of conscience. Why? Take, say, freedom of assembly. You want to get together with people, but not to have some sort of grand again. You want to get together with people in order to speak to them about things that matter to you. In other words, freedom of assembly assumes and requires freedom of speech. But equally, freedom of speech, you're welcome to come together if you want to talk about the weather or anything. But freedom of speech really assumes and requires freedom of conscience. You want the freedom to speak about those things that matter to you because you are bound by the dictates of conscience. Now, if you think, we're in an age of growing consumerism. But freedom of conscience is not freedom of choice. Freedom of choice is autonomous. Choose what you like. What food you like, what friends you like, what spouse you want to marry you. Choose what you like. You are totally autonomous in terms of consumer choice. But freedom of conscience is not autonomous. It is respected because far from being autonomous, you are, quote, bound by the dictates of conscience. Martin Luther, in many ways, gave the first public declaration of this when he was on trial for his life before the Holy Roman Empire. And he said, "Here I stand, so help me God, I can do no other." He was bound by his conscience to those beliefs that he believed were true and right and just and so on. And it wasn't a matter of whim or preference or autonomous choice, like the choice of music or clothes or food or friends or whatever. He was bound by his conscience and he would not be moved. And that's why conscience is respected. In other words, as philosophers put it, conscience is the inner forum. And we respect people's freedom at that level of the inner forum. When they, pursuing an examined life, are convinced that something is true or right or just or important, and they're bound by that conviction, we respect it. But that inner forum is the parallel to the outer forum of the public square. And when you have freedom of conscience and a free public square, then humans truly have a genuine freedom. Now, it's important to see freedom of conscience is far more than freedom of worship. Every dictator, take, say, the North Koreans, or even the Chinese grant freedom of worship. But what do they mean by that? Usually, dictators mean whatever you're thinking between your two ears, so long as your mouth is firmly shut. Now there's something totally inside your own head. Now what sort of freedom is that? Sadly, even President Obama, in the 8 years he's been president, has been talking about freedom of worship rather than freedom of conscience, and even he has a very shrunk and impoverished view. But if you've read the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, freedom of conscience means the right to reach, to hold, to exercise or practice, to share, and to change your convictions. Now those are radical, far more than freedom of conscience. And you can immediately see those who are upset by that. For example, very obviously many Muslims are. Have you noticed that there are some Muslims, not all, thank goodness, but some, who welcome the right to become a Muslim, but if you choose the right not to become a Muslim, you might suffer honor killings and die for the faith, and many have. In other words, the right to become one should be the right to leave it, but they respect one way, but not the other way. And you have inconsistencies like that. Or again, there are many atheists in the West who challenge the right of people to share their faith, as if all sharing of faith was coercive. Now, of course, any sharing of anything should be persuasive, but not coercive.